watching on this great Blood Bowl Sunday. Tonight we're gonna see our season concluded with the Pros Final, played between Bill Cower, Power Hour, and the Princes of Arioch. I put up the teams here so we can take a quick look at them. It has been an interesting season so far. The two playoff brackets were absolutely different, as we will see. By the way, I think some other accomplished MML coaches and broadcasters will join me, even for this pregame show, and later on we'll be quite some people here in the booth. So far I'm by myself, but I'll just go ahead and start to give a quick look at the team. So as I said, the two playoff brackets were very, very different. On one side you had a bit more Bash. There were two Necromantic teams, a very, very tough Lizardman team, and the Bill Cower Hour, who you will see here. On the other side of the bracket, it was a bit more the beautiful game of Blood Bowl that was played. We had a couple of Elf teams. We had Rodentia ad nauseam, a Skaven team. We had the Stop Rolling Ones, a Wood Elf team, Haraldson's, my team, another Wood Elf team, and the Princes of Arioch. So we saw quite a lot of scoring on that side, while on the other side, the teams were busy bashing each other. I will just post my link in the Twitch chat so everybody sees. In case anybody wants to join me, just let me know on the Twitch chat or on Discord. We have these two teams here. Let's take a look at their route to the finals here. First off, we got the Bill Power Cower Hour. We can take a look at their entire season, in fact, because on our little history screen we see everything at once. So these are their seven regular season games, so the top two rows, the bottom two rows, and the game against Los Pumas. And you see that they don't score a lot, of course. I mean, they're a Chaos team. In no regular season game they scored more than two touchdowns, mostly 2-1 or 1-0. So it's a typical Chaos result, I'd say. I mean, you do the 2-1 grind, or you score early and hope to hold the opponent off, as you see in the games against the Green Tide Titans. They started off a little tough with a draw against the Yeatjobs, but then their season changed for the better with a win against Witch's Coven, a Dark Elf team. So they did well against Elves this season already, which might be an indicator for our final game later. They tied Walking Dead Reanimated, a very, very strong, very bash-heavy undead team. 2-0 against the Green Tide Titans, who many expected to see them in the playoffs. They missed it. They won their bowl game. It was the Goblin Gambling Bowl, and their coach Thunden actually left the team to coach a new upcoming race, a Nurgle team in the Challenge League next year. Next game against Elf was also 2-1 win for the Power Cower against the Blitzkriegers, another Dark Elf team. So the two Elf teams they played this year were Elf teams, Dark Elf teams. And then they won 2-1 against Rodentia ad nauseam, a very, very good Skaven team, a very versatile Skaven team, and in the end they beat the season 4 champ, Los Pumas, 1-0 to secure their playoff spot and clinch the first seed in their conference. The playoff games were very interesting for them, I'd say. We saw the Leaping Lizard in the first round, and that was an interesting game. I mean, it was pretty much decided by turn two, both teams coming in with heavy inducements. Leaping Lizard got the star player Slibly, of course, a very, very vital piece for Lizardmen offense. And Coach Morshots actually countered his move, hiring the star player, with a wizard. So he threw in his own cash to get a wizard for that game. Used it turn one, destroyed the entire cage around Slibley, left Slibley by himself, went onto him, injured him, out for the game. 3-0 win for the Power. I see right now Coach Sirius Jest is joining me here in the booth. Hey, Jest, how's it going?
How's it going? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you just fine. I'm just going through the Power Hour season so far, basically, and took a look at their games. I mean, it's interesting that they...
What an amazing season they've had, huh?
It's a great season. It had a rocky start. I mean, two draws in the first three games, but then it was all glory for them, basically. And I mean, they played three agile teams this season, two Dark Elf sides and one Skaven side, and they won all of these games. So they know how to handle the dodginess, and that might be interesting for tonight. And I was just saying how they basically destroyed the Leaping Lizard side in the first round of the playoffs.
No, it's funny. Morshots has been around since season two, and I've had the pleasure of knowing him since season three when I joined the MML. As a coach, he has grown tremendously in the three seasons five seasons that he's played. Early Morshots in the first couple of seasons did stress a lot about his game, spent a lot of time worrying about it, thinking about it. I remember back in season three, he would be a day before his final game to see if he could make the playoffs. He and I had a conversation on a text where he was, or in the PlayStation chat, where he was telling me that, you know, the nerves were ramping up for whether he would make the playoffs. Somewhere around, you know, maybe the next season or something, it became like a running joke, right? Like, the Power Hour doesn't make playoffs. They're like fan favorites, but they go to bowl games and they do well. Morshots shifted from putting a lot of pressure on himself and just enjoying the game. And that's, you know, the things that he started to do were like switch to what he saw as a difficult conference. So you saw him move from the West to the East specifically so he could be in a play pool with Don Eagle, with Thunden. He was trying to load it. He wanted to have it be these very tough teams, and he wanted this like sick conference where nobody could ever be undefeated because it was just, you know, the amount of teams that you would play are difficult. But he just wanted to have fun. He wanted to play against good coaches. And you've seen that happen this season too, where he just, you know, he's doing things to have fun. The leap into the the leaping over the player who, before he scored the touchdown with the Beast Man, before he went in and celebrated the touchdown, that was amazing.
It was really
just a capstone on what kind of coaches become.
It was insane. And if you see the entire history of this team and this coach, I'd really like to quote our commissioner Preach there, who I think in the first or the second episode of this season's podcast, he said Shots has a shot for the title, and he really likes his approach as a coach, because Shots doesn't go for a one season glory with his team. He built the team slowly up. It's a very well developed Chaos side. We'll look at the roster in a minute. It's a very well developed Chaos side, and he made them stronger every season. He built the team, not only the team, he also built the characters. You know, I mean, you saw the showmanship of the Leap Beastman. You see Maker's Mark performance, which is always on people's radar. He really developed this team in all facets, basically. And we all say it's tough to coach low level Chaos, but when you really get to know them and how to use them, where to position them, they become a dangerous team like the Power Hour is now.
Yeah, I mean, that's very correct. I say this over and over again. The MML is definitely not just about the coach, right? It's all about the franchise. Not only because, you know, the enjoyment aspect of having good stories and people reading, you know, and people developing all, you know, that's great, and that's part of what makes the MML awesome. But also from a winning perspective, I mean, if you are patient and you are willing to keep the same team, even when you struggle, you know, you have a bad season. Morshatz has had bad seasons, and he stuck with the team and said, you know, I got a long-term plan. I'm going to build him a certain way. And if you can do that, I mean, some of our storied franchises that have been around for a while, you look at them, you look at, you know, the Power Hour, you look at the Green Tide Titans, although they're going away for at least for a season, you look at the New Orleans Grunts. Like, over time, you take a look at those teams, those coaches are walking in with a distinct advantage, because not only do they have a high TV, but it's a high TV that is saturated. It's built in a very efficient way, you know, so it's not just, you know, a few games, wham, bam, here you go. That those teams have players that have a role. Everybody is part of a big working mechanism. And Shots will tell you, you know, Knob Creek took a – when he first joined the league, he was one of the leaders in casualties inflicted and KOs, and everybody started, you know, making fun of him that he doesn't cause the same kind of casualties and doesn't – you know, he's not on a big leader in the stats anymore. And Shots says, you know what, that's not important. We're built as a team, and what he does is he plays his role within the team, and that's, you know, that's the approach that he's taking, which I think has led to more wins.
Exactly, and let's take a look at the roster. I mean, we started talking about it. We might as well take a look at it. I mean, you get the four Chaos Warriors, all of them very, very strong, very well built. Maybe Jack Daniels falling a little bit behind there, but doing his special job of getting to the places when he's needed with a dodge skill there. And what is so interesting to me here is you see a roster of 11 players, and every player is at least level 3, and that's only one. I mean, you got a couple of level 4 players, and then it's level 5, level 6, level 6, level 5, level 6. You know, that is a very, very, very well developed and balanced Chaos team you see here, in my opinion.
It is hard to pick a star out of this team. I mean, the guy that's really made the biggest mark, I mean, you know, his name has been all up, you know, in the sound bites this season. It's probably been Irish Carbomb, because he's new, he has a particular set of skills, you know, the pilot, the claw palm, that Shots does not have anywhere else, I think, on the team, right?
No.
Only claw palm player?
It's the only piling on piece, yeah.
Right. And, you know, some other Chaos teams will rush to the claw palm even before they get blocked.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, this team is they've built the other aspects of it. And Carbomb, he's the conference leader for the most violent player, with 8 casualties inflicted on the year. But Kotkowski also has 5. So again, even he has his work spread out. I mean, Carbomb is not going to chase a player down just to up the stats and inflict a casualty. Carbomb will chase a player until the edge of his zone and let that player fall into the trap of one of his other teammates, and that's how these guys work.
I mean, who we also have to talk about when it comes to stars is definitely Stolichnaya there. I mean, that move in the semifinals, after a very, very tough game, those teams didn't stop at first blood. They went for it, tried to do as much damage to the other team as they both could. And when it was kind of sort of decided, when the last couple of necromantic players were laying on in the dirt and his beastman was going towards the touchdown zone, Stolichnaya just did something insane. Tell me about it.
He decided to, in a choreographed celebration, was he the guy with the ball? I don't remember if he was actually holding the ball. Who scored the touchdown?
I'm not sure if it was another Beastman or if it was Stolichnaya. I think it might have been Stolichnaya.
Yeah, I thought he was the one who just hopped the ball carrier. But in a choreographed celebration, Stolichnaya decided to go and leap over his teammate before they ran the touchdown in, which was, we'd never seen that. I mean, with the game literally on the line. If he failed the leap, they were going to overtime. I mean, it was turn 16. So... and just an amazing play.
And I mean, Coach Shots, and you told it before with his approach to having more fun with the game, not being so obsessed with winning anymore. He said, one, I had a good feeling that I wouldn't fail. Two, even if it goes to overtime, I think I still have pretty good chances. And I think not a lot of coaches would do that, would say, I take an absolutely unnecessary risk to put some extra show in there.
I mean, it is a stupid risk. I told him that. He is a madman. It was dumb as hell from a practical perspective. But it is exactly the kind of dumb that the MML loves. I mean, it wasn't really dumb. He took a calculated risk in saying, you know what, I could fail this, but the kind of glory that I will get from completing this is way beyond, you know, just scoring the touchdown and going to the finals. You know, we have now, we're season six, right? In season six, we have had, before this season, five other sets of finalists. So you're looking at 10 coaches, and, you know, some of them are repeats, but somewhere 10 coaches before now have gone to the finals, right? But nobody has gone to the finals in that fashion.
Yeah.
And that was what he was going for, and that's the glory he got. So I think Morshots definitely gets it. It's not just about winning the games. It's about feeling the adoration of the crowd and having everybody in the chat going nuts and talking about that moment for season six. We'll probably still be referring back to that moment in season 10.
So with game time approaching slowly, let's take a look at the Princes of Arioch. I mean, their season has just been insane. If you look at the number of touchdowns scored in total, if you look at the results, this is insane. So this team did not only have a fabulous regular season, they actually took the top spot in the entire MML. With 18 points, I believe. No other team achieved 18 points here. The only game they didn't...
Don't rub it in, Lou. They did that by beating my team.
The only team...
Should have been my spot.
They didn't win to was the Seven Deadly Sins, which is very surprising to me because the Seven Deadly Sins, coached by former champ Seston... they are a team that had quite a tough season. I mean, they were fighting relegation until the very end, and they won a game against the best team in the MML. That's a bit surprising. And to our viewers out there, what makes it interesting for this game is the Seven Deadly Sins are also a Chaos team. So one might think that the Princes of Arioch, strong as they are, might struggle with Chaos.
Here is where... I think that there is validity to that theory. All right, but first let me say this. As you pointed out, Seston is our season two MML champ. His first season in the MML, came in and won the championship. He's had three different teams. This was a new thing he was trying out. You know, he's coached Tiles before at the MML level. He coached Lizards. So he decided to try the Chaos thing out. I think Morshots and Thunden called this in the podcast, or maybe it was Hez, did a podcast early on our MML Pro Talk podcast where they did the season preview. And they said up front, hey, we think this is going to be a building season for that Chaos team. They didn't expect a lot out of them. They probably didn't expect it to be as bad a season as they had, but it's tough. You know, young Chaos at that level, they're tough, and it took a while for Morshots to build the Power Hour. It was going to take a while for Seston to build up the Seven Deadly Sins. Unfortunately, it looks like due to personal commitments, Seston's going to be sitting out season seven, so we won't see the fruits of his labor yet. But they're on their way. They're dangerous, and it just goes to show you that every single coach at the MML Pro level is dangerous. They can beat you on any day.
It's crazy. You know, it's crazy when we look at the playoffs this year. Not a single former champion made it to the first rounds of the playoffs. Nobody. Nope. That is crazy, right? That says something about the level of coaching here. And we saw it. I mean, Kaven, who is referred to as master of positioning all the time, he was fighting relegation until the very end. I mean, how crazy is that? Somebody who made the finals twice, who won it, who everybody thought would have another shot for the title, has to fight relegation all of a sudden. This is insane.
Yeah, just and I say this all the time. I mean, just make the playoffs. If you make the playoffs, you have a shot. Yeah. Anybody could win.
Yeah.
And if you get in the pros, you know, anybody could win because I mean the level of competition is that close. I mean, everybody's great here. But back to your original thought. Yeah, here's where I think Sasser could get in trouble. He took on this high elf team, the Princes, last year. He abandoned the Seattle Treehawks, who were the wood elf team. because he liked the higher armor on the high elves. He felt like he could build them in a way that more efficiently did some of the things he was doing with the wood elves over time, but with the higher armor value and more longevity on the team. What I've seen, as somebody who's been in his conference for the past two seasons, is Sasser has he likes to bash when he can in a guerrilla warfare style, more so than, you know, most wealth teams. A lot of elf coaches, especially the wealth coaches, will avoid contact. You talk to Reznor Rules You, Rez will tell you if he only gets 33 blocks, if he gets in the low 30s blocks against him during a game, he's probably winning that game. Sasser will try to dodge out, establish sick numbers, gang block, and then gang foul an individual, mark people up, you know, do what he needs to do. He plays a very, like, aggressive defense with the elves and even aggressive offense. And I think he's really enjoying that armor 8. The problem is that when he runs into a squad that, like a chaos team that can outbash, like this chaos team, that can outbash him over time, he may have to fight that urge to throw that one block too many that gets him in trouble and then gets one of his players taken out because he left him exposed.
Or fouling, and I mean, let's look at the Princess roster here real quick. I mean, they are also fielding 11 players, coming in with 4 rerolls. The team is not as balanced as the Power Hour is. I mean, we got a level 1 player, we got a level 2 player there, we got 2 level 2 players actually, a couple of level 3 players. You don't have the level of class overall players. I mean, we have the crazy war dancer type, Yurkun, basically. He's one of their absolute superstars. Cedric, a crazy thrower. I mean, wherever he is, he can easily throw a last second pass even without any problem. Rakir, the vamp catcher, basically. Also pretty good. And Shardros, of course, a potential one-turner there. So, I mean, those are all great players. But at the top of the roster, the bottom of the roster, you find a couple of players that are not that skilled. That said, you notice it. You said it before. Do you think Caesar will foul a lot in this one?
If given the chance, he will. Normally, I would say, yeah. I mean, Sasser is always open to a good foul. Mm-hmm. If there is a key piece laying on the ground and he can surround him really quickly. Most coaches are not ready for that, especially not from an elf team. They're not thinking, oh, the elf team is just going to swarm me like a bunch of rats and then, you know, lay the stomp down on my guy. Sasser will do that. I think that Morshots, though, has anticipated that. He knows that's he's coming. He's probably watched the game film on him. And the other thing is that I've said this before, that if there's any weakness with the Power Hour, I think it's the Power Hour are actually built to handle dodgy teams like elves. I think Morshots didn't like elves running around him and, you know, put tentacles on players, put tail on players, you know, put a bunch of tackle on the team. Maybe sacrifice some of the dominance mm-hmm. that he might have against an orc team. You know, again, you don't see a lot of claw palm mm-hmm. on the Power Hour because they were more worried about people that could just go around the claw palm. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he worried about these other skills. So then when he runs into, like, orcs, he can get in trouble because the orcs are dwarves, because those high armor teams will take advantage of his lower armor.
Yeah.
But I think Morshots will be ready for the princess. I don't think Morshots is going to leave many players exposed to get fouled, and then I don't think Sasser's going to take that.
I mean, he doesn't have tentacles. I believe Morshots doesn't have any tentacle player on this team. Just a couple of tails.
Oh, he must have lost them. He had it a while.
Yeah, I think he had one. Back. Yeah, I think it's just tails now. Yeah, but I mean, tentacles would be that would be
doesn't stack as Morshots likes to play.
Exactly. I mean, the tentacles wouldn't be so useful against a high elf team. All of them having at least strength 3. Even there's one strength 4 player. So tentacles not that effective here. I mean,
The tail could make things a problem though.
Exactly.
I mean,
it
makes it a 67% dodge instead of the 83%, and you couple that with tackle, and
that's it. Exactly.
That becomes an issue.
Okay, so I just heard from the coaches, and they're warming up right now, actually, and they might go pitch side soon. I think we're still good on schedule for a kickoff in 5 minutes. So, I mean,
Awesome.
looking at our chat here, I mean, the stadium is just packed. We're lucky that we're playing at the Power Hour Stadium, I believe here, which is actually a quite big stadium, a level 3 stadium, with a beer stand, so all our coaches out there can be entertained all the time. I think Coach Morschatz with Bloodweiser being a sponsor and a regular participant in the Bloodweiser Bowl won't run dry here. And the chat is pretty active. Everybody's excited. Everybody's hyped. I feel there's a slight favoritism of the Power Hour because people actually argue that the High Elves roster isn't big enough. I mean, High Elves coming into this with an 11-player roster, it is quite a lot, I think. But people say they would need a bench. 11 players is not enough to survive this.
No, I mean, I don't think that's a lot for a high elf roster. It would be a lot for a wood elf roster to come in with, with that many or even Skaven. But high elves don't tend to die as much if you protect them right. That being said, it would be optimal, I think, to have a 12-man roster for the high elves so they have an extra guy in case something happens. With this team, maybe 13 even, or like with the team that they're playing against, but the key will be to staying healthy, and Sasser has to be smart about that. So we'll see whether he, plays conservative and protects his guys on defense, or whether he goes reckless abandon, jumps in cages, and exposes his guys to maybe getting lit up.
Speaking of which, 12 players or something that might still change last minute. We saw that the Power Aura spend a bunch of their money on a wizard in the first playoff round. The Princes of Arioch have been rather conservative with keeping their funds alive. Do you think Sacer will actually go for an inducement here, or do you think he will keep the money for his transfer target?
My person, I'm just going to speculate here. Sasser has been around since season one, and this is, I think, his first shot at the championship in a final. And if it were me, and I've been waiting for 6 seasons to get my shot at a championship, I'm not going to pull a Stu and hold on to my money for next season. I'm going to say, hey, one shot, one kill, let's get this. So I'd spend the money
I mean, and
by
also
a
looking at
wizard
his
special
TV,
case.
both teams have an insanely high team value. He can't bring a superstar target in because otherwise he would his team value would explode even with bonus TV, you know?
Yeah, you got that. He's probably gonna have to cut just to make weight.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, because now you gotta, I mean, he's over by now. Actually, if he buys a wizard, he'll be right on point, and nobody levels in this. You'll have 100 TV and BTV in to add to the 1900 cap, and he might be able to keep this team as is.
So with us now is actually Coach Fnords, or Count Fnords, coach of the Walking Dead Reanimated. How are you doing, Fnords? Are you there?
Just fine, just fine. I have been sleeping a lot today.
I mean, you had quite a
Fnords is
busy
fresh
couple
off
of
a great
days.
MMO pilgrimage, right?
Yeah, it's been good. It's been very good traveling in England and meeting all the guys. That's been good for sure. And I'm really looking forward to this game right now. It's going to be an amazing game, I think. Have you guys said who you think is going to win this game? Have
We
you
haven't actually.
any
Good
ideas?
question. It's a tough one. I think the Power Hour has the better odds for them just by being able to outbash early on, probably.
Having played against the princes, this is tough, but I think that I'm gonna go Sasser on this one in a close match. I think the general elfiness will keep them in, even if they lose a few pieces. I think they'll be able to avoid the it getting locked down in a corner, and it's gonna be close, but I'm gonna go Sasser.
Fnoritz.
And also pick up to the first four.
Fnoritz, what do you think?
Well, for me, it's going to be... We have two different games being played here today, I think. We have the name of the game of numbers.
Mm-hmm.
And we have the game of those fast turns. I mean, those when you only use one or two turns to reach the end zone for a touchdown for the Elves. And the question for me would be, is Shots going to reduce the numbers enough to be able to effectively defend against a very skilled high-up team that could might move up the pitch and score in just a few turns, or even one?
Okay, so Sacer is... he got a wizard. We're right in our assumptions. He is going for this once-in-a-lifetime title shot. He hired the wizard, and they're marching onto the pitch right now. And, I mean, it's kind of an obvious one, right? I mean, how many times is he going to go there? I think he's confident that his team is going to be good and healthy next season, but you never know if you can make it to this point. So better throw it all out there, right?
Yeah, plus, like you pointed out, I mean, he's going to have TV problems anyway. He can't hire somebody else. It doesn't make any sense for him to hold that money.
Okay, I don't... Do you guys see... Is your crystal ball ready? Because mine is not.
I haven't kicked over yet. It could be that they're still in the opening festivities and haven't popped up yet.
I might be just blind. It's always very embarrassing if everybody in the Twitch chat sees the game already.
Let's see. Yeah, there it is. Page one. You found it?
No, because...
Go back to page one.
No, it's not on page one for me.
I meant to refresh.
I have the game. You should search for NML. In
there
the
it is. There it is. No worries, people. Relax. Okay, so we are going pitch side now, and this is exciting. I mean, we're going to have a first-time champion. Did we have a High Elf champion? No, so we will have a first-time champ race here. No Chaos team, no High Elf team has ever won it. Dignity was favored by a lot of people, I think, when they made their run for the title, but their run got stopped early, so... And no other team has ever made it that far, right?
What, to the finals? There's been a... the Dignity made it.
Yeah.
A couple seasons ago. Last season, I think, right? Dignity went all the way to the finals. But yeah.
No, last season it was the Wrecking Crew against the White Elves. Yeah.
White Elves. It's the one before that it was Dignity.
Yeah,
but
so...
They lost to... It was to the Wrecking Crew, I think, yeah.
Let's take a look at this stadium here. You see this beautiful beer stand here on the side. Everybody in the stands is getting pumped here in case any player will leave the pitch. And I think we have frenzy pieces on both sides, right? So both are well equipped for a surf fight here.
Yeah, and both of these coaches are good at surfing, so... If given the chance, they will take advantage of it. Sasser is one of the bashiest high elf coaches you'll find.
Yeah. I mean, I saw that myself last round, right? He took out a couple of my guys early on and it was over. And I was like, these are elves. What are they doing?
Yeah. Wait, what is this? I thought I came to an elf fight. Is that allowed?
It was a scoring fest, not a bash fest. Yeah, but I mean, you said it. I mean, this might backfire for him. I mean, if you want to go bash here, you will probably lose it because there's not a whole lot of more bash teams than the Power Hour, right?
It makes sense to engage with a Wood Elf team if you're High Elves. Your armor's better. But it does not make sense to do that against a Chaos team. I found that when he played against my Necro team, the Hopeless Necromantics during the regular season, he actually did score really, really fast. He didn't do well started.
Ooh.
And look at that. The crowd is whipped into a frenzy. A fight has already started. It spills out onto the field. And by the time that the refs pull everybody apart, we have lost a turn.
That's what we expected in the finals game, right? I mean, that's what we came here for. That's exactly what we want.
Might have been a too much
and
fear.
The crowd seems to have amped up the players because Malik knocks. The other elf is teammate. Valharic knocks Stephen Gorkowski senseless, and then his teammate Malik follows up on Warren Sapp.
Yeah, you said something very interesting there before. That was about how to engage and when to engage and what to just hold back with these bash yells. I mean, I found playing the Walking Dead Reanimator, which is a semi-bash team. I mean, the high strength mummies and everything. When playing against the power hour, you don't want to bash. No one wants to bash against the power hour. You're gonna lose in the end because those armor breaks are gonna add up. It's the epitome of a bashy team, I think, in MMO. So I do believe that they're gonna try to score fast here, Dales, and they're gonna try to make something happen to avoid as much conflict as possible and just go get those blitzes in.
I mean, you see here by the princes a bit of their classical offense, right? I mean, they try to take out a couple of fast pieces, send their receivers in scoring range, basically, to have a good couple of scoring threats in turn two. And I believe we see much more advancement. We'll see a little screen or half screen being set up on his right flank, basically, and then our superstar thrower Cedric will probably hang out in the back with the ball until he sees an open receiver somewhere down the field, right?
Yeah, this is a risky move, though. And I'm gonna credit with this defense? I want to say that the first person that we saw, because I remember announcing a match where Chase JJ actually took his orc team, sat a bunch of orcs right here in the middle where you see the Irish car bomb sitting, and said, you know what, I'm just not going to let you get behind me. I'm going to leave three guys here on the line. They're going to bash with you. They're going to hold it down. They're going to delay you. You can run your guys up. But if you come onto my side of the field over here, I'm gonna destroy you and not worry about you getting behind me. So running your, you know, doing the typical elf thing of running your players down the field, to me right here, is extremely risky. When we've been talking about this. Yeah, and that doesn't help. Now you've got elves hanging out. He's got, I mean, to his credit, he's got four people in scoring range.
Yeah.
So, you know, chances are, if he can get that ball to one of them, somebody's going to be able to score.
Exactly.
But, you know, to Shots' credit, he has enough people back that he can make this a headache.
Especially with the tails. We talked about the tails before. I mean, the combination of tail and tackle here, I call it a good TNT build here. That might be tough for the elves, right? Because, I mean, elves with their dodginess, with their high agility, normally can dodge through everything. But with a tail on them, it's a bit tougher, and it makes you roll dice not that easily.
Yeah.
Having said that, we have high agility elves here. The tails doesn't really come into effect that much if you don't put multi-tackle cells on these guys.
Yeah, I think he's doing. You're right. Like, you don't want to leave it in the hands if he's not going to make the dodge, right? But if you can put at least two guys on each one of these receivers, then that.
Ooh.
So Carbomb, trying to extend his stride, almost fails, but he did some extra wind sprints this week, which helps him get where he needs to go. Rakir is going to get felled because this, you know, he's got tackle. Oh no! Wait,
nope.
What?
Irish Carbomb doesn't have tackle.
My bad.
Yeah.
I thought he did. So that keeps him, that keeps Rakir alive, but it also puts him out of scoring range. Just out of scoring range.
Yep.
Yeah, you make it difficult, right? You put two guys on every guy, so catching it becomes a 50% deal, and then you make it tougher for them to dodge out with 67% instead of 83%.
There is a very big chance of seeing a score here. That's a very good option.
I think so too. I mean, with high elves, it's really tough to close their scoring options down. Exactly. I mean, yeah. And we've cheated. Oh, that's good.
The listener does not have block.
Ooh!
Hey, oh, that's huge.
That's very huge. That is very wow. And of course, not gonna see an apple there. No.
And especially
that
for
is
the,
a major weapon gone, for, though. That's their ball carrier. That's the leaper. That's the guy. That's their wild card. And the elves, just, I mean, they must have heard us in the box. I know Sasser was in the chat during the pregame, and he must have came back and told them, hey, these announcers don't think you can hit with the chaos. These elves said, many say, what? Mm-hmm. And they showed what's up. They can bash. They will bash.
But they only focused on the... They focused only on the bashing. I mean, we've seen the passer, the thrower actually failed the pickup. Now we've seen our AG5 wannabe war dancer here failed the easy catch. And I mean, it's good that they put in some extra training this week, but I'm not sure how long they can keep up with those the sloppy mistakes here, right?
Yeah, they need to be focused. I mean, I like that they came out fighting. They came out scrapping. They said, you know what, we're going to give it to these chaos, and we're going to give it to them good, but they need to concentrate on the fundamentals if they're going to win here.
Speaking of which, and handoff is good.
No stalling this time. He's going right for the uprights and slam dunks it between the goal posts. Then takes off his helmet and laughs in the direction of the Power Hours bench.
I mean, Coach Rez would have huge criticism for this touchdown. I believe there was not a lot of showmanship going on this one. I mean, he ran it a bit diagonal there, but that might not have been enough to please Nuffel, right?
Yeah, I think there was a blood offering made, though, so Nuffel might like that.
True, I give you that. So, to follow the tradition of our greatest MML announcer, the score now is Princes of Arioch 1, Bilkaur Power Hour 0. It is Blood Bowl Sunday!
Trademark. Blood Bowl Sunday!
And now we see what the Power Hour does on their... I don't want to say... offense drive, I want to say more bash drive, because they get a couple of free blocks and I think they will use them.
And having that, I mean, their ball carrier off the pitch, I mean, they have another one, but still, it's he's not really a ball carrier, he's just a secondary backup guy. And it's going to be interesting to see what happens here.
By the way, this is where it hurts as a high elf coach to... Kickoffs are the worst, because if you're coming in with a team of 11 players, most of them, like on this team, everybody has an advanced set of skills. And you got four catches who are AV7, and you have to leave some of them exposed. So even when you're running this column defense that they got going, mm-hmm. this is the usual Wood Elf setup, mm-hmm. as you'll notice. He's forced to choose which one of his players are most important, and he doesn't want to leave exposed. But look at the guys he's leaving up there. He's leaving his one-turner up front, subject to a blitz, and I bet you that Irish Car Bomb is going to be going for. That's the guy I would go for.
I mean, we see it time and time again in the MML here now this season. The one turners have been targeting quite heavily, and even teams that doesn't foul that much have been getting them on the ground and jumping on them.
Nuffel continues to favor Coach Sasser and his great coaching, and blesses him with. Another point of good karma, just in case the dice don't fall his way later.
I mean, what is huge with losing Stolinchnaya? You got another AG4 beastman here. I mean, we all know how difficult it is to actually just pick up the ball with an AG3 team. I mean, every necro, undead, orc, whoever coach is desperate to have that one AG4 piece, but you see how well built this chaos side is because Coach Morshots managed to bring two AG4 beastmen to the party, and that's really important once one of them goes out.
Absolutely. Curious. So we did not. We actually saw Gokowski piles on to Yuntrick once he got him down, but they choose not to use Irish Car Bomb. To attack, that was Bill Romanowski, not Bill Romanowski to attack Chargeros, that one turn catcher. He is more concerned with creating enough roadblocks for the Princess to not get in his backfield. He knows Sasser's preferred way of playing defense is to flood the backfield with these elves and then try to take advantage before you can set up a cage.
Yeah, exactly.
He's not allowing you to do
that. You see that. You see him not wanting to set up a cage. It's a very wide screen here for our dedicated ball carrier, the AG4 Beastman, and he will take his time to really establish a cage and give this this offense some progress. I mean, he doesn't want to give the opportunity for the elves to just knock the ball loose at all, because we all know what happens. I mean, he has AG5 pieces, and you know what happens when the ball is knocked loose. I mean, we have a couple of teams, Skaven, Wood Elf, who've shown this plenty of time this season. Ball is loose, AG5, AG6 runs in there, dodges through like 8 tackle zones, throws a gigantic pass, and score it is.
And meanwhile, by the way, we've just been talking about Chargers. I mean, wow, it just seems to me like Sasser's just taking a cavalier approach with these players. This, to me, is disrespectful if I'm the Chaos team here. If I'm the Power Hour and Chargers runs behind my screen like that, I think it almost, you know, pride demands, honor demands that you smash him, foul him, beat him out of oblivion, remove him from this game for even thinking about being so disrespectful.
And he's the guy who injured your Showman Beastman, right?
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah, I think so.
No, I think it was Elric. Chargers did the scoring. They both leveled, actually, and I mean, we've talked about it. It will be interesting to see what Sacer does in regards to TV management here, right?
For next season?
For next season. Because he's at 2,000 already. Two more level ups.
2010, and then he had 10.
Yeah, so 2,000.
Yeah. So now he's at 2,000. 2,000 with remember, we have a maximum BTV limit now in the MML for next season of 100. Yeah. So the league cap is 1,900, and I'm sure he has, as a coach that's been around for 6 seasons, I'm sure he has 100 BTV already banked. So he should be good at 2,000, as long as nobody levels.
Two guys leveled already.
He'll be dropping on you.
Two guys leveled already.
Yeah. Sorry. Well, then he's dropping a reroll, is my guess.
He probably, yeah.
He's play a little more conservative next year. To start, and then he'll get it back.
By the way, now that the High Elves are setting up their defense, how to stop this scoring drive early on, and as you said, they play rather aggressively, right? Send a couple of guys down the field already. We can just take the time and take a big shout out there to our chat. We got a ton of coaches tuning in, I think 35 right now. Chat is going crazy, showing support for both teams here, and it's great to have so many coaches the Sunday evening or afternoon for you West coaches out there to tune into this and show those coaches especially the appreciation for the great season they've played so far, and also thanks to the coaches for scheduling such a East and West friendly time so the entire MML can tune in. Except Baldwin.
They did it on purpose.
Yeah, if Baldwin is out there, big shout out to you, buddy, at 5:30 your time, 5:30 a.m. that is. But for everybody else, it's just the perfect time, and it's great of our coaches here to agree on a time where everybody can tune in and watch this.
Carbom tries to lay the smackdown on Rack here instead of Chargers, and unsuccessful, just manages to annoy him, basically. But it looks like the Power Hour is going to be able to construct at least a screen of some sort. Here's the issue, though. You talked about the wannabe war dancer. The princes have that leaping piece right there. A leaper, a strip baller in Yirkun. Mm-hmm. If you had to pick a star for the princes, that's the guy that gets the most pub. And the problem is, if he gets anywhere near your cage, you're in a lot of trouble, because none of Morshots' carriers have shorthands. I'm not sure if Stolichnaya did. No, he didn't.
Nope.
So, if for a team that looks like they were built heavily to deal with elves, not having shorthands is a big oversight, I would say.
What I find interesting is that with the blitzes so far, he decided to blitz with Carbomb. Of course, a brutal piece, known to do a lot of damage, and he's done so all season. But without tackle against an elf team, it's interesting that he's the dedicated blitzer.
I think what they're wanting to do is they want to, you know, they're thinking, if I get him down, I'm gonna hurt him. And this is ballsy right here. Hand off to Jack Daniels. This is a blodger. And we know, I think we said it in the pregame, there is a stark lack of tackle on the Prince's team. But the one player that can get it done is the Leaper, the Agi-5 Leaper.
Oh!
And oh! The Wizard comes in early. The Prince has dropped the fireball! Knob Creek knocked out. But Bill Romanowski just eats it and says, is it raining out? Is it drizzling?
And the big thing is, of course, that Jack Daniels stays on his feet. I mean, there are options for the High Elves to get to him, having a couple of guard players in the area. So it was effective in the sense that he will get to the ball. But it will not be guaranteed that he can pick it up afterwards, because the Wizard only affected two players.
He's gone, man. This is off to the races. What's going to happen right now is you're going to have Divum jump in there as well. So you've got one guard piece. Divum's going to guard him up. Oh, really? He's not going to...
Exactly.
He's going to take it like that? One, yeah. He's going to go one die?
He's worried. Red die?
It's a red die?
What is he...
Why? I guess he wanted to set up the after effects, and it does not work out. I mean, it's not a terrible chance to take a red die with a strip baller tackle piece who has block, but that was kind of an unnecessary risk. I see what he was trying to do. He's trying to set it up so afterwards he could definitely get the ball to that receiver and take off, but no.
I mean, he had two guard pieces in the area, right?
He did. He could have brought in that second guard piece. He could have brought in Divum. Supplement that could have been at least a one die, and he could have probably got in another piece, but
he probably didn't see the guard on Bill Romanowski, because I believe he put the dodge lineman there and maybe just missed the guard there on our beastman.
I don't know why. I mean, Sasser's a much better coach than to miss something like that. I thought that the easy play was you could have brought two guards in,
exactly,
marked up the ball carrier, dodged out, took the leap onto the other side away from Romanowski, and free the ball up, and then all you got to do is get it. Then, I mean, Cimarro can run in and run away, and I see he was trying to set up the pass afterwards, but I don't know, what that was not the way to do it.
I mean, that's what I said. You have to think about where the ball could land, and if it's then in three chaos tackle zones potentially, that would be tough. But I still think you should make sure to not get skulls there. I mean.
Right. I mean, a red die block is to me a thing of desperation that you don't do unless you have to.
And also now with our war dancer down on the ground, I'm surrounded by a couple of chaos players. Just saying, might not end well for him.
No, this is perfect for the power hour. Like the momentum of the game just shifted.
I mean, now
Wizard is burnt. And this is gonna get ugly. And now, are we gonna start seeing elves coming off the pitch?
They can kill box some here. I mean, putting some tails and tackle and everything. He just box these elves in, and just keep bashing them and fouling them.
Mm-hmm. We won't see a foul. We see a blitz instead.
Yeah, and I think Power Hour is worried that a foul. They don't have a bribe, right?
No.
Yeah, so a foul that goes poorly, like the High Elves, every player on the Power Hour, like you said, there's only 11, but everybody is important to this.
It's team. Only 10 so now.
Can, yeah.
So their numbers is. Oh, and yeah, he's that's ejected, interesting.
This is
that's
interesting,
very
yeah.
interesting. The Jack Daniels
and
potato here.
And giving us the nod over here in the booth. And he's holding up a bunch of French fries he's eating, and it looks like he is celebrating the potato. We got a potato up the sideline by a chaos.
And that is, again, a very interesting decision. I mean, you have the leap dancer in reach, of course. You can bring a couple of guys over there. Did he feel he was not safe in the cage there, or?
But this is going to be a two die with tackle against him,
yeah.
I think.
Of course.
I think Shots is trying to push the momentum, and will it be enough? This is going to be a one go for it. Oh, and he leaps out! Fails at first, but regains his footing.
And now it's tackle and strip ball. Two die.
Yeah.
Down he goes. He double pow.
Because Nuffle's giving out pows. Boom, pow.
He doesn't want the ball in any one of these players' hands.
I'm going to make my little report and notepad for questions to the coaches, because I think we have two very good ones already.
Maybe Shots was thinking, I want to get this ball closer to my end zone, and I'm going to bank that he fails to make the make the block. Because, honestly, if he stayed in that cage, he's probably not scoring. It's just like, I think Sasser would have flooded him really quickly, surrounded him, and not let him get the touchdown. So Shots wanted to tie it up, and he thought, this is my best chance. If I could survive, he's going to get one shot at me, and if I can survive that, I'm in the end zone.
But, I mean, it's turn six. I mean, he had time, right, to progress down.
I'm not saying I agree with it, but I think the thinking was, knowing Sasser as a coach, oh, and there we go, failed GFI, falls on top of the ball. The ball gets loosed. I think what he was trying, the thing, what he was thinking was, if I stay in this little area over here, they're just going to surround me and box me in. I'm not going to be able to go anywhere. I think that was maybe his thinking.
I don't know, but Sacer, I mean, it depends on how the power aura can do things this turn. But there's only the push on our kicker lineman here.
We're going to see a surf.
We could, but... But Chardros is still down there, only marked by one defender right now. And that is a permanent scoring threat there. You know, if any of these elves picks it up, we can see a long pass. Oh, and Divem is injured. So that evens the numbers, right?
Yep. One of the catchers gone. That's a big deal. With guard.
I mean, he doesn't use the guard pieces, as we've seen, so...
I think he got greedy, man. I think Sasser got greedy, and then I think more shots just said, you know what? Momentum's going my way. I'm feeling it. I'm going to ride this phone. And genuine style. And let's see. I think the blitzer's going to be Ramanowski, right?
Yeah. There it comes.
There it comes. Little tackle action. And only a push.
Push away from the ball.
Yeah, it's enough to free up Jack Daniels to pick that ball up and make himself a hard target again. And now you've got other chaos that if he can survive the block.
He needs to do the pickup first.
Oh, he can't, but he can't even pick up the ball.
We're talking AG3.
Right there.
So who of the elves is in the area? AG5.
So they spent the reroll.
I mean, it's probably not that tough for Sacer to get a 2-die there, or is it? I mean, he has Rockier there, right? Rockier is strength 4. So with the assist by the catcher who's on the ground right now, he can get the easy 2-die there. And so it doesn't make a big difference if he has the ball or not, because Rockier having tackle, he goes down no matter what.
Like, I was getting shocked by Shot's decision to potato that one. It must have been some overconfidence in that large player.
Oof! No need for the 2-die here.
That is his game decided for sure.
So Yurikun picks up the ball, but doesn't know what to do with it right now, because he looks down the field and there is Chardros. Chardros is marked up by a beastman. Does he want to risk the throw towards Chardros right now and just score it? I'm worried.
Oh,
if he
word YOLO. Uh-oh. Welcome to the MML, the home of the YOLO!
Interception. Wow.
Beastman interception rejected. You see a Dikembe Mutombo Ram Chancellor rejection. He says, no, no, no. And are we going to see Jack Daniels get another chance to trot into that end zone and do the celebration he's been practicing choreographing all week? No, he's coming back. So they're going to give it to
him. They're playing it safe here. They're playing it safe.
He has two turns.
Back ram.
Yeah.
He does have two turns, but if they could free up Beckram, that's easy. Yeah, they can get the through the blitz to take the person off the ball carrier now. Which they can
by
do.
The way,
they can get Karolak on.
Was it a pass attempt or a punt attempt?
No, I think he was passing.
Because the chat is saying punt. The chat was saying punt.
No, not a punt.
I can't see the reason for a punt there.
Yeah. So I guess he's either gonna dodge out and hand it off to Beckram, or he's going to he's just gonna.
You can see that he can just blitz through, right?
Yeah.
I mean, having horns and tackle and frenzy.
I mean, these elves have been lucky so far, staying on the pitch with so few injuries for Chaos.
Just a push.
Giving him just a push. But he gets another two die. Yeah.
That worked in his favor, actually.
Yeah. I mean, that's the way he needed to go no matter what.
It's going to get her done.
But this is still not safe.
Yeah.
It's still not safe.
It's not safe at all. And that was why I was thinking, I thought that instead of running, who was it? Did Warren Sapp run all the way down there to provide the assist? Whoever it was, I thought that was going to be a blitz. Maybe it was Juani Siragusa. I thought he was going to blitz.
Yeah, I thought that was going to be a blitz as well.
And then pass. I thought we were going to see a Chaos touchdown the last one. We're going to go for it.
And now the elves have options here, right? I mean, can the AG4 piece, it's a catcher with movement 8, so if the scatter, if Ram Chancellor goes down, leap is good.
Easy leap. Will the dodge be just as easy? There's no tackle on what's his name, the Chaos.
Problem is, he wants to have the scatter in a different direction, right? I mean, he wants the scatter to go favorable for his AG5 piece, so there could be a pass still, right? You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yep.
Man, and that is good. That is good. That is good. That's one go for it. Dodging out there, another go for it, and he can make that pass with the AG5 piece, and I think that's what we're going to see.
And he's going to try for the YOLO pass again.
I love elves.
we might see a pass to the catcher.
You might see a pass to his face to the ground, but no.
It's AG5.
Now Cimarol's widening up that arm.
AG5, no skills.
He can't long bomb it. Long bomb it. He needs to go for a handoff.
No interception
long
this time.
Pass
is good. And
wow.
We have a catcher.
No rerolls.
And we have a catcher. Oh, what the tail!
Wow.
Hey, don't ever say tail's not useful.
Would have failed anyway. It was a one. It was a one.
Still, it was the tail that made
destroying the fun loop.
Yeah, stop shooting holes in the argument.
I'm German. That's what I do, right?
Okay.
We can't have fun here. We can't have fun.
Irish car bomb is going to pile on to no avail. And we could be seeing a Chaos touchdown, but they're gonna need to clear Yerkun off of that ball carrier.
Whoa!
Oh no!
He wanted that reroll for something else.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, somebody needs to pick it up, somebody needs to receive it, and somebody needs to do a go for it or a dodge, so
This is surprising.
Wait, why is he doing that?
Yeah, why is he doing that?
He decided he's not gonna go for the touchdown. That's so weird.
My little notepad comes out again. Y, no, T, D. T, H.
I am very surprised by everything right now.
To be honest, at least it's a good show, right? At least we have plenty of things to think about.
It's a good show.
And it goes back and forth.
I get the feeling that Shots is sitting over in the on the sideline thinking, what can I do to screw with the announcers next?
I mean, there's still options, but they're not good ones anymore.
Yeah.
I mean, it's an AG4 piece, right? So he won't have much problems picking up the ball. Thing is, he will have to throw a pass, right? And, I mean, yep. Shots is known for passing with Chaos, right?
Mm-hmm. Maybe he wants the long pass. I don't know. He thought the short pass or handoff would be too easy.
And that's also interesting.
Another curious decision.
Also interesting, right?
He used the blitz to free up the receiver.
I don't know what's happening.
That's we're going to see a crazy pass.
Okay, it's going to be crazy.
Chaos YOLO.
He's a wild man. He is a wild man. Knuckles had enough. Maybe Shots knew that one was coming. He was like, you know what? I know I'm gonna get screwed. I might as well have fun.
I just want to say one thing right now. I'm very happy that this final has such a great stadium to host it. I mean, it's always nice to see developed stadiums. And was it Kaven who did a tour around the MML stadiums? And I think it's time for a new edition, because this is a very nice stadium. Love to see
that. Hilarious, by the way, in the chat.
Creek is still down. He's still not woken up.
And that's a big one.
He took a pretty hard hit from that wizard. That he took the brunt of the fire. I think I heard him say, "Ow, my face."
And I do believe they even have a weird babe, right?
They do, but I mean, it's hard to appreciate the babe when you can't see from your burnt eyelids.
Yeah, that's bad. That's bad. I feel sorry for that.
This is the chat is hilarious, and Robo Whale said with the chaos pass, it was Chiolo coming.
Well, so there's a few things you can do here as a chaos team. There's a few things you can do here as a chaos team. I think it is trying to continue to get the number advantage, get as many of these scoring threats down, especially the one turning threats, and then score at like turn 16. That would be a good thing, and hope to get into overtime, because I do believe that Chaos can have a better position in overtime. The more this game goes on, the more injuries I think would stack up for themselves. But
we haven't seen that many.
I can't even guess what's gonna happen next.
No, I have no clue. I'm done guessing.
I mean, and also thinking about taking it to overtime. We have a very developed elf team. We have a agility 4 strip ball war dancer, basically agility 5 strip ball war dancer. It is risky to stall it out until turn 8. If you're going for that,
I don't think you're gonna see the elves allow much stalling. You're gonna see Sasser flood the backfield again.
And that's the thing. I mean, if the elves force Shots to progress this faster, to not stall it out, to not cage up fully, to have a fast scoring drive, they only need 2 turns. Worst case, they only need 1. You know, and if they score again, I can't see the chaos, the power of scoring in 1, 2, or 3 turns even.
There are no injuries, no chaos. Mm-hmm. This is not going power of way.
Exactly. Yeah, if it keeps going like this, I mean, the Chaos need to win the War of Attrition. If it keeps going like this, it's going to be an easy Ariok win.
Yeah, for sure, for sure.
And Maker's Mark with the nasty right hook, but it's only a stun again. Man, these High Elves must have been practicing letting the coach punch him in the face all week, because they're just taking it like champs.
Nuffle give us and Nuffle take us away.
Yeah, I mean, we've seen it, how lucky his injury rolls were against Leaping Lizard there. I mean, he took out one Saurus after the other, right? And those freaks are strength 5, armor 9.
Poor Hess being pitch cleared as well.
Yeah.
Maybe they're just all worn out. They've spent all their energy.
Yeah. It's been a long season. Yeah. I mean,
they're not used to the postseason being more than one game, right? Like, normally is Bloodvisor Bowl and that's it for them. So while the High Elves are thinking about how to assess this, there will be another game on after this one, people out there, because we have a two-league system right now, with this being the pros. We also have the Challenge League, which is... It's tough to say it's a second division, but we have a relegation promotion system in place. And so we see the two best teams of the Challenge League, who will both be joining the pros next season. So that's some high-level Blood Bowl there. It's going to be a different game because we get Orcs playing Dwarfs there. So I think we'll see a bit more blood than we saw so far, because this has been disappointing in the blood department, right?
There's still a lot of match to be played, though. And here's my thing, Lou. I often say this, when we think Orcs and Dwarves, we make the math mistake of going two bash teams equals a lot of blood. But honestly, because of the high AV, those teams tend to be a big car crash that doesn't go anywhere.
Wow.
And there's the red die block, unsuccessful at first, but the follow-up leaves him...
Yeah,
at least leaves him on his feet. But that for how long is the
play? He's going to have to get out from there. I mean, he's going to have to get away.
You can't stay there. You cannot stay there.
And he used the reroll
That's a
already.
Bad spot.
And he used the reroll already.
Go for it. Look pissed, though.
Yeah.
Oh, he's going to leave him there.
Wow, that's
it's
amazing.
It's because he used
having
the reroll.
Tackle pile on Michael Bow. Wow, no, but yes, he has dodge that player. I mean, he's a tackle piece. So yeah.
Go for
yeah.
it.
I don't care, man. No, you don't leave him there. That's mighty blow. That's mighty blow with claw. You don't leave him there, bro.
I mean,
you
maybe
get out. Go.
Maybe he's thinking of how to trim his team value.
a sail dodge is a very
efficient
dodge is
way.
Better than a face full of claw mighty blow.
That's like 200k trimmed in team value, right?
Yeah, right there.
Chuck is playing a bit more conservative now. He's actually moving his pieces in contact before he does some blocks and stuff.
I mean, but Caesar is playing everything but conservative here, right? I mean, doing the red dice once and then failing it, doing it again. Whew.
Wow.
He dodged the bullet on that one.
Know, I don't hate the red die. I don't hate the red die block with a strip ball. I don't think that was terrible, but leaving him there was very risky.
I'd be so afraid. I mean, you get two, three, four rolls to make to get out of there, you know?
Yeah.
And four times not a one. And you see, at least Schatz has to do three blocks now to get him down, if he even goes down.
Yeah, I mean, that's because it worked out that way.
Now he goes
down.
Now he goes down, but no mighty blow, no pylon, no cloth, nothing on that piece, you know?
Good enough.
But also good enough for Caesar, you know? There was three blocks, three pieces who could not move this turn.
Oh yeah, for sure. I think both coasters are quite happy anyway there.
Schatz finally having that piece down and out for the next turn. Because that is a threat you can't control. I mean, Caesar is willing to throw red dice there, we've seen it. So you can't defend against that, you know?
We still have some dangerous pieces, but that's the most dangerous for the ball carrier for sure, especially with this not fully constructed cage.
And see, this is what you can't get overconfident and start marking up the elves, because Sasser will just move into position to outbash you. I think both Jack Daniels and Maker's Mark are going to get a fistful of boomstick.
And they are, for sure.
I mean, he has the numbers advantage right now, it hurts to say, but... The Chaos are outnumbered right now.
Yeah.
Interesting follow-up.
Yeah, he chooses not to stay in contact, but I guess he has other people he can provide.
Maybe he wants to. Maybe he has different plans for Rockier. Maybe he has different. Yeah, he has different plans for Rockier there, because he's the vamp elf. He gets his Sudai anyway.
He's coming around. Oh.
And the vamp comes around.
There you go, Rakir. You're leaving Odell Beckram of the ball and his senses.
This is going to be interesting.
A bounce off the limp body of Yirkun into the hands of Steven Gotkowski.
But we might see... it's going to be tough. I mean, he will get people there.
You're going to have a one die block on him.
No, 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 no. He just got up.
Die.
The guy just got up. He just got up.
Yeah, there's no threat to ball carry this.
You can mark him up.
Yeah, you can mark him up then, heavily, so.
And I mean, we've seen shots being lucky with this bounce. I believe it was a farm game, right? Was it against Yufnord? Where the ball went. I think the ball carrier was, or the receiver was in the end zone.
From the turn before.
Yeah, fumbled the pass or something. Ball went out of bounds, bounced all over the field, and landed up back in his hands, caught, touchdown. That was brilliant. Yep. He's a man of scatters. Yeah.
Oh, this is going to be interesting here. I mean, right now it looks like it's an easy win for the Elves so far. I would say so.
It depends all on how these blocks go, and I mean, if you can free up the ball carrier, if those three elves go down, different story.
It's not enough. He needs to remove players. It's not enough to just block them away.
Yeah.
There you go. That's a big successful block.
That's
right
a good
there.
Hit on a good piece.
And a good result. Jarjo's knocked out.
That's good.
It's a big deal. And that's the one turner.
I don't know. If I was Caesar right now, I would have even been tempted using the Apo now, because in this turn it will be decided. You know, in this drive.
Yeah, I mean it's not. It's
nah.
Not
a... No, they're gonna get out here. They're gonna block that guy away. They're gonna move him away. But they still have the threat of that AG leaping, strict balling tackle piece. So I mean. He's safe so far. I mean, he's a good position, whatever. The power of that here.
I'm surprised that's what he chose to do. I am very surprised, but it works.
But it's a very good
move.
Because
he did extra ballet lessons this week, and you're going to see Steven Gotkowski prance his way out to a potato in the center of the field. And now you're seeing... Shots is over on the sidelines eating a baked potato with chives.
Let's say I see
towards the booth.
I see an option for Zazer to get to him. There's an option, I think.
Yeah. Oh, there's great options for Zazer here.
That's crazy, right? It's a crazy play again.
Shots is just having fun at this point. He wants a legendary win.
Works.
Zazer to spend a reroll before Gotkowski gets floored. But I mean, oh, and he's gonna catch it!
Ooh, that matches
what
it
a
up.
Move, right?
It's gonna be—he's gonna be fine.
Down, loosening the ball.
He's gonna be fine with
the ball off his teammate right into his hands.
With Gotkowski stunned, I think he's fine.
Oh, I mean, yeah, play to have fun, but you know, you also want to win. I guess Shots is thinking wherever he's gonna be at, he's gonna get to me anyway.
Yeah.
So I might as well just potato, give him one shot to make it. If it doesn't work, I'm in the end zone. This is tough.
Coach Stefan Junk there and out in the chat just made a great comment out there. So the season of the rabbit became the final of the potato.
The Bill Power Potato Hour. Bill Power Potato Hour. So I see why it says...
I do believe that this is a game to entertain us, and it is an amazing, entertaining game. I mean, we have no idea what's going to happen. I mean, absolutely no idea.
Maybe he has faith in his interceptions.
I don't know at this point. I think he's having fun. he's like, looking for a win for sure, but yeah, he's having fun here.
The removals weren't coming, and maybe he's just thinking, you know what? I might as well go down having fun. And that's,
yeah.
Now Sasser has
two scoring threats.
It's not even going to be any blocks now on any ults. It's going to be a one blitz, I think. Oh, yeah.
The ones come, though. Cimarole is going to help the Power Hour out a little bit by knocking himself out on the ground. How will the Power Hour respond?
A game is definitely not over. I mean, if you can mark up one of these guys and then take the other one off the pitch, there's not really too many scoring threats down there then.
Yeah, but you need to dedicate two players to each of those receivers, basically. You know?
Basically three to the, vampire elf.
And that's the thing. I mean, he will blitz him probably, right? With Ram Chancellor there?
Nah, the AGP is the most important to blitz away, I believe.
Yeah, that's the guy they're going for.
Because the other one cannot receive the ball as well in tackle zones.
It's just, these Chaos are just not breaking the armor.
Maybe with the pylon. Phew, not even the pylon is good.
Yeah, the chat is just echoing what we're saying here. Like, he needs removals to make something happen here. Surprising what's happening here.
He's gonna blitz around and he has the other piece back. Wait a minute. Okay. So.
Interesting vanity reroll on the frenzy piece, right?
He didn't want to mess around with it. He didn't like it. And the vamp elf is down for the moment.
I mean, the follow up would have only been a one die, to be fair, so.
Still, this is a very, very easy score.
Yeah.
It didn't have to only be a one die follow up.
Yeah. Yeah, depending on sidestep. Sidestep.
Oh, yeah, sidestep. Yeah. Oh, okay, that's right. That was...
Coach Don Eagle's pointing out there, man, I wish this armor rolls would have been against me.
I think every one of Shot's opponents that played him, man, this season would have wished the same thing, to be honest.
I mean, and that's what we all say. I mean, we're all complaining about dice after losses and blaming things, but in the end, it always evens out in a way, right? And that's what we're seeing here. I mean, not taking anything away from him.
But the has been played absolutely completely amazing in this game.
Yeah.
Hand off, and then you're gonna see it. Pass, yeah. This is a.
Are you?
This is an 83%.
It's 83 leap on, and it's done.
Yeah. And still reroll in hand, right?
Oh!
There goes the reroll.
Forces him to burn. We still have a game!
Oh, and we have a game, yeah. This is interesting. This is amazing. What a turnaround.
This is crazy. This is one coach is saying, you know what, screw it. I'm just going to do all kinds of kooky stuff and screw it. And the other guy's playing textbook, and yet there's somehow still a game.
That's why I said, are you going to see the pass? Because I think he would have been safe in the pocket there with a guard piece in front of him, you know?
This is Sasser's thinking is let me just cut his throat right now. Let me end it right now.
I don't know. I mean, taking one turn more off the clock, I think I would have gone for the stall there because you were relatively safe in that pocket.
Mm-hmm.
And now we've seen some interesting stuff here. We're gonna see a pickup with a beastman running up, relaying it, running it as far as he can, I think. But a blitz maybe getting to that EGP's there. Yep.
Whatever you're guessing he's gonna do, he'll probably do the opposite. So don't even bother.
I do believe that he actually got the most obvious way here now.
And are we going to see the next potato? Probably out there.
This is not the potato in the same way, though. It's a different kind of potato now. Because
yeah, of course.
There's sales on those guys there.
Yeah.
That sounds like an advertisement for a new restaurant. A different kind of potato.
Handoff or pass?
Right, Wormsat picks up the ball, and I think you GFI it.
Yeah, probably, right?
That is the safer option.
Yeah.
Unless you spend the reroll doing that, and he doesn't want to burn the reroll. He's going to let it sit there. That's a curious decision.
Also
let
interesting.
It sit there.
Wow. Every time one of these coaches tries to do anything this half, it just doesn't work out in the end.
I think he had to spend the reroll there, man. That's...
Yeah, I would have done as well.
You
I
know,
mean, three
that,
turns
that
left, two
said,
rerolls.
Yeah.
That being said, maybe Shots' thinking was, hey, the potatoes haven't been working well. I spend it there, I run the ball up, try to hand it off, and I get burned again trying to give it to what's his name, and then they just get it right back anyway.
And will I get a similar chance
wow.
next turn?
Another one! Nuffle says no! Here comes Vamp Elf. Are we going to see the leap? No, he doesn't have the...
No.
He's marking up points.
Yeah, but he has to roll another go
oh,
for
he's
it.
He's thinking, should
he?
Has
to,
yeah,
he's
yeah,
like,
yeah.
oh, what if I roll another one here?
But he's committed.
And I mean, I think that's what Shots was thinking by not using the reroll. I might have a similar chance or an even better chance the next turn. I mean, Caesar will move a lot of his pieces here no matter what. And it will be
well,
a different
look
situation.
At that play there. He used the he's blitz, like, but it didn't actually blitz.
No.
That is interesting.
He's too afraid of the go for it.
Yeah, exactly.
It was
yeah.
more important to have that piece there. Even though it's kind of not.
Thinking...
I mean, the thing, he needed to move his other guys.
Exactly, yeah.
He needs to. That's what he needs to do. If you have failed there, turnover. Yeah.
He's yeah. like, I can play defense against this. I can't recover from failing this one.
And that's...
Wow.
Exactly what he's doing.
Three
I mean, now it's kind of the opposite game, right? I mean, you got two beastmen downfield as potential receivers. I mean, the Chaos are forced to play High Elf now, and the High Elf
are
forced
to potential receivers. To be honest, I mean, they are marked up too well, I think, to actually do anything here.
Even that Agi 4 piece is going to be a 50%.
Because he can't reach end zones. I mean,
no.
It doesn't matter if he gets the ball.
And with AGs, I mean...
He actually could, if he wanted to get desperate, right?
Yeah,
he could
push.
Yeah, blitz Golkowski, run for the end zone, and then pick up the ball, hand off, 50% handoff to Odell, who dodges out and throws it to the end zone. It would be a crazy Elfy play, but it could happen. But, you know, I mean, Power Hour still got a couple of turns, so...
Yeah.
I think he's going to actually start to play a little conservative here.
I think he's going to start playing a bit more conservative now, trying to move the ball up to make the craziness that will be there in turn 16 a little more likely.
Yeah. And here comes
Power
Carbon
is playing hard now. They're putting the players up there.
Because Caesar knows how to defend against this, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. And I think Power Hour hopes to take out a couple more pieces until turn 16. And then, I mean, setting up
nothing
a crazy play
arrows,
now.
Though.
Yeah. Crazy play nothing now doesn't give you anything.
Okay, so successful pickup now by our leader, Worm Sap. What to do with it now, though? That's the question.
Yeah, you hand it off. No.
I mean, what does the handoff get you? They can hit him the same way.
Yeah.
Actually, he's got block.
Exactly, yeah. That's what I was thinking.
But Shots is also thinking, to get there, I gotta go for it and make the handoff. And the way ones have been flipping, thanks. He's gonna make the assassin where the dodges.
Shots have two more turns and two rerolls now, so I mean...
Yeah.
It's interesting, this one, for sure. Yeah.
The scoring threat is gone for next turn, though, now. And for the one after, yeah, he's stunned. So, Golkowski's no longer a scoring threat. And Sasser's still trying to. He manages to free the ball from him. wrestles it loose. Now the ball's laying on the ground. The question is, can any of these elves get to the ball?
That shouldn't be hard.
You might see Sasser, yeah, send Yirkun for the touchdown.
Yeah.
That's going to see. Oh, no, no. He's just putting him short. No, he's not that crazy. What did you advise? Yeah, I think
it's not easy to get to that ball right now for Sasser.
It isn't.
Not at all. Oh, it might be, though. If they can fit one die block here. Oh, two die block.
Open the door for the other guy.
For their thrower to come through.
Not good, though.
But Maker's Mark stands up to the challenge and says, that's all you got, Puck!
Still, though, Chaos needs to put some scoring threats. They made it easier that they freed up one Jack Daniels. So they can create a good scoring threat in him as well. But they need to have at least two or three scoring threats up there.
Probably the easiest option will still be putting Odell Beckham Jr. out there, half potatoing him and just throwing it to him in a crazy manner.
What you heard. This ball's about to get picked up.
You need more scoring threats. You need more scoring threats.
Yotrick tries to pick the ball up successfully. You're going to see the YOLO pass.
No. I mean.
Yeah, here comes the YOLO pass. That's how Sasser plays.
Yeah.
And it's Horny Siragusa in place to make an interception. No, he doesn't get it this time.
Yotrick makes
the pass and he's caught. That could be game over. That is most likely game over.
And that's the thing. Even if that pass had failed, and even him, Yurikun, being out there by himself, the distance right now is almost impossible
to
cover.
Okay. No, it is still okay, actually. There's ways you can win this game as Chaos. They're not that strange, actually.
But Shots has screeched this a million times. First thing first. There you go. Put somebody in scoring range. There's this guy in scoring range who is marked up.
Now he wants to put the AG4 guy in scoring range.
Yeah.
I mean,
but
that's
he needs more scoring threats.
He only
one.
He needs two, three guys down there too, because otherwise Sasser can just mark him up with four people and that's it.
Yeah. He's done then.
Yeah.
You gotta move Odell before, unless he's thinking I lose the ball and I gotta pass it to Odell.
Ooh, that's interesting. That's very.
What?
Why?
No, that's no good now. To be honest, that made it more or less impossible now.
Why? Why did you do that?
Well,
you get the two die anyway. He has horns.
Yeah, I'm very surprised right now. You need to try to pick up at least.
Yeah, otherwise it's over.
He has to spend it now. You have no reason not to. There you go. Picks it up.
Yeah. I'm so surprised why he put the second guy there first.
What? And he left him in surfing. Was it a go for it to go for another space?
Yeah.
Or?
Yeah. He needed to go. He was in go for it range already. Yeah.
At this point, it doesn't really matter if he's surfing range, right?
Exactly.
Did he lose the ball or not?
He even still has the apple, you know, like.
Wait! Did you guys just see? He moved the Agi 4 piece back, so he is relying on Jack Daniels for the score.
Exactly.
He has to.
Jack Daniels has dodge.
Does. 1, 2, 3, 4.
I mean, 6, if you're Sasser, you can play that very easily right now, right?
Yep.
That's
very. You may have to commit some forces. I mean, it's not very easily, right? Nothing's easy. You got
to wait, guys. We have a jump up one. We have a jump up one as well.
Ah, Gorkowski. Steven Gorkowski. That might be the tricky one, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
There's options that we didn't see.
Mm-hmm.
Good call.
And I mean, that's probably.
Maybe Shots is banking on him not realizing that.
Well, you said something about Baldwin before, and he's actually in the chat.
He's in the chat, yeah. Big shout out to him. I mean, that's dedication. I mean, I stayed up for the last season's final until 5:30. He set his alarm for 5:30 to check this out.
By the way, the chat's saying that, you know, they agree with him putting the other guy down there. I don't really have a problem with that. Why move him first?
Yeah, because exactly, it could have been easier for him.
In case something bad happens with the block.
Yeah, but it could have been easier for him to pick the ball up, you know?
So Sasser decides to be interested.
The ball can land anywhere now.
Yep, it might actually help Chaos. Wow. Oh, I was going to say, it might help him if it
exactly.
It's not that bad, though.
He loses the ball, and he's going to pick it up, and it's a touchdown.
Look at him!
In his face, and he dropped the ball at his feet. He said, what now?
Look at him!
MML champs! MML champs!
He's laughing
in
his
face.
Charlie
Murphy! Charlie
Murphy! He's laughing in his face. Did you see that?
Yeah, it was an amazing one. Yeah.
Wow.
That's the game, guys. I mean, crazy things could happen, but I think that's the game.
I don't see a theoretical chance for this turning
yeah,
around.
There's not even a theoretical chance left.
2-1 turners? No.
Riot extra turns.
Not even 2-1 turners, no. He can't do 2-1 turners. He doesn't have the personnel for that. I mean, he has a frenzy piece, but...
Wow.
Yeah, what a game.
By the way, since we have some downtime now for the first time, Lou, tell us about the new shirt.
This new shirt? Ah, it's actually an interesting one because it has a difference of patterns. I mean, you can see some dots, some, what is this, flowers, some lines here, some caro here. Love it.
Was the person that made that shirt high on LSD?
I mean, you could even see it as like a screensaver, right? You know, me moving around like this. Weird screensaver.
An altered mindset. If one were to get in an altered mind state and stare at that shirt for a half hour.
Actually, what
you see Jesus?
If you stare weird enough, like cross your eyes and look at it the entire time, there's a unicorn hidden behind this.
That shirt is definitely a unicorn. That's a good description.
And you see what Coach Schatz is saying here? I don't care about the ball anymore.
Where? Okay. You mean on the field?
Yeah.
He's gonna show these haughty elves a little something. They need to respect the chaos. And what is this little position that the princes are taking up on their own logo? And cue the music up. Ding 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 ding. Jam on it, jam on it. They did a little choreographed flash mob there in the middle, and the game is over. Wow. Definitely one for memory here. Bill Cower Power Hour finally gets invited to the big dance and decides to show up wearing a tuxedo t-shirt, get drunk, and piss in the punch bowl. The Princess of Arioch getting outbashed, definitely. 16 armor breaks to 7. But the passing game came up big, even though the Chaos pulled down an interception. Only 20 blocks thrown by the Princess, so only and that one injury made it seem like it was going to be different at the end, but nothing huge here stats-wise.
No.
I mean, the huge thing here is 44 succeeded blocks, 1 KO and 1 injury. That is the huge thing in this game.
Considering there's 3 claw pieces, 4 or 5 mighty blow pieces, frenzy piece, two pylon pieces. Yeah. Let me
check. Nuts. I wonder if we're going to get the coaches in here.
Let me check. Let me send them an invite again. I sent them an invite before the game, but I'll just send it again. I believe we got coach more shots already.
What a game, shots. What do you think about this one?
I think my controller's going to die.
Good timing.
Or it's going to, like, running out of battery.
No, it just ran out of battery, actually.
I think my controller's gonna die. No, yes, die, controller!
No, it was a good game. It was a lot of fun. I got no complaints there.
You guys put on a show. I mean, the first half, it went back and forth the entire time. You both did crazy plays, I think. What's your new thing with the potatoing? I mean, potatoing the Beastman, potatoing the Chaos Warrior.
French fries. potatoes a la gratin.
Well, you know, there was a guy before the game that kept talking about how we can't score, you know, more than 2 points. So we figured we just, you know, we potato a bunch and try and get quick scores. It didn't work out so well, but you know, one of these days we'll score a few touchdowns.
Yeah, have you announced officially about the Power Hour's future?
I officially don't know what the future is yet. I've reached out to a few farm teams. I've actually looked at going into the Challenge League with a basic Chaos, you know, team just starting off from nothing. It's really one of those where I have no idea what's going to happen yet. It's one of those where until the season was done, it was really up in the air, and I still don't know.
And I believe we got the champ walking into the press room right now. Congratulations, Caesar.
Congratulations.
Brilliant season.
Congratulations.
Crazy final. Very well played there. Good one. You there? Can you hear us?
Well, thanks for the congratulations, guys, and thanks for competing and for everyone that watched. Another great game, Shots. That was a super close one. Definitely could have gone either way there for a long time.
It was a lot of fun. You play elves really, you know, just at the top of their game, like you and Stu. It's tough matches. Every time you watch them, you know, it's one of those where you use them to their highest efficiencies. So, I wish you could have got another armor break or two on you, but no, you didn't leave a lot of open shots, and I did my best to give you a good solid match, and you know, You got a solid win there. Nothing held against that. You kept the pressure on the whole time.
Yeah, a couple of your potatoes there looked like they were gonna cross the line and make it through, but managed to snatch the ball back from you right before you scored. So that was
both of you guys did some things that we just were not expecting. Shots with the potatoes and you with just the reckless abandon on hanging your catches out there in the face of a team full of a lot of killers. And it's like your guys just said, you know what, bring it on. We could take a punch. And it was amazing. So many of them were left standing. Post-match, the first thing I said was nothing crazy here in the stats. And Lou pointed out, no, what's most impressive is the lack of certain stats. With 44 blocks succeeded on this Chaos you know, team full of killers and only one KO inflicted and one injury inflicted. What did you do this week to get your guys ready to take the kind of punishment that they did and just, you know, and just keep their chins up and keep their consciousness intact? Did you put them in a room with a gimp or what?
I bought flak jackets for all of them and they were wearing them under their uniforms. Yeah, nice. I got really, really lucky with the armor breaks. That's for sure. In the beginning, since I had the wizard and had players in scoring position, I was really trying to push the pace early on and figured that if I could get a second score in the first half, it almost didn't matter how many players I lost. But I obviously didn't get that second score and probably didn't use the wizard to full effect and was pretty anxious heading into the second half. But luckily those armor breaks had saved me and I was in a decent position to play the rest of the game a little bit more traditionally. But yeah, if I have a player in scoring position and there's a chance to send the ball the other way, I was definitely taking it. And it burned me a couple of times, even when I had a couple of good high probability attempts. Like that Beastman interception, that was phenomenal.
Right.
People, but yeah. The press room is going crazy here. We have a couple of reporters from all places in the MML. People from Bretonnia, people from very weird places where they speak very weird dialects. I think Nords can talk about that later. Are you willing to answer a couple of questions from the community here?
Yeah, definitely. I'll answer a couple of questions.
Okay, so the first one is, what type of underpants do you favor? We can skip that. one question is, Zacer,
briefs.
Did you did you instruct the scorer in the end to gloat on that beast, man? I mean, he was picking up the ball, throwing it down to his feet, and then just laughing in his face.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's the only thing that can be expected of a high elf blitzer like that. He, you know, ran a complete circle around his opponent, picked up the ball right between his feet, and scored the touchdown. And that's the only thing.
That's a blatant lie. It was a half circle. There was only 180 degrees covered. He missed 180 degrees. He's a half high elf.
Next one is from Jofro. He wants to know, and this probably goes to Caesar as well, was there a moment in this game prior to turn 16 where you thought you had it?
So right before the Beastman intercepted the ball, I thought I had it, because that relay, I think, was just 283% rolls, and I had the re-roll in my pocket, and so that one, I thought I had it pretty well secured at that point. And then that Beastman leapt up there and snatched the ball out and kept the game in limbo for the rest of the time.
Next question goes to more shots. I mean, there was a situation where you were setting up scoring threats, basically. I believe it was turn 14, 15, around that time, when you basically had the chance to get the ball in your backfield and had to leave a couple of scoring threats there. It looked like you were going for that Chaos Warrior, Jack Daniels, I believe, the dodge one. But then there was this jump-up piece. Did you try to basically sneak him there, so hoping Caesar would miss the jump-up and could score with him? Was that your dedicated scorer there?
I had both of them there. I was hoping he would forget about the jump up, and then I would have that second option. The first option was the Chaos Warrior. It was one of those where I wanted to try and put a couple options out there and at least be a little bit sneaky about it. That being said, it was one of those where I could have probably put four or five players back there, and he would have seen them all. It's one of those where he's a solid coach. We've played, I think, two or three games now, and yeah, it's just one of those where every time it's pushing me to be a better coach and you know, to find new ways and that. So yeah, no, I had an option or two. I knew it was a long shot, especially after the ball was all the way up at the other side of the pitch, but. Yeah, I wanted to really try and keep hope alive a little bit there, and you know, thus the positioning of the EG4 and this, and for that same reason, a couple of the other pieces. But yeah, no, it was one of those where we were playing for overtime a bit, and you know, the Elves did a good job of shutting that down. So I got to give them full credit. They you know, from turn 1 to turn 16, they had the pressure dialed up, and we just couldn't answer the bell quickly enough. So I'd like to congratulate them. A game well played, and just a lot of fun wall-to-wall there.
Very, very kind.
Had a blast, Shots. Well played, and thank you for your congratulations. You've been a great opponent over our, I think you're right, three-game series across multiple elves.
I think it was the third one, yeah. I like the wood elves better. They treated me nicer.
They squish easier too.
Yeah, if you just get rid of the tree men, I would have just enjoyed that team a lot more too.
I've got to run, but if there's one more question, I'm happy to take that before.
What type of nightwear do you prefer?
Whatever's comfortable, that's for sure.
On you or on the significant other?
Both.
Yes.
I think for Shots is power hour bathrobes on both, right?
No. Just me.
Just you?
Yeah.
Somewhere this interview took a weird turn.
Did it though?
I don't like the direction we're going in here.
All right. Thank you for everyone who commentated and everyone who watched and everyone who participated in the season. It was another really fun season. Had a blast. Looking forward to going forward.
Congrats, champ.
Thanks. Bye, guys. Have a good one.
You too.
See you.
Yeah, so, I mean, there's another question of who's the best Swedish singer in the MML. I believe we have all seen that live. If you haven't seen it, you might want to friend Thunden van Strutten on Facebook and check out a couple of the latest videos he posted. You might see... quite well-known Swedish MML coach singing there. Yes, Stefan Junk, the CL Finals will be on Twitch as well. I'm not exactly sure on which Twitch it is. I think Rand the Mad volunteered for announcing. And somebody else also did. I'm going to check that in a little bit. Not sure whose Twitch it's going to be on, but it will go online in around 30 minutes from now. So just check the Discord. I might actually. I can just do it because then I can put it on my Twitch, right?
Yeah, you That's just easy. Twitch it and then
yeah. get everybody on there. And then the other guys join. Nice, yeah. Okay. In that case, I'm gonna Twitch it and it's Rand the Mad, somebody else. I don't remember who, I will check in a bit. Those two will announce, I might join them, and I think Harry Warthog just threw his head in the ring as well, a very, very well-known Challenge League expert there, who I'd be glad to have in the booth. That would be fantastic, and I mean, anybody can join if they're interested. The booth is always open.
Once again, guys, thank you for a very, very entertaining game. Probably one of the best the whole season. There was so much going on that we actually didn't have any downtime. We had someone to speak about the whole time. Big congratulations, Acer. And best of luck, Shots, whatever you decide to do. If you stay in the pro or if you go for the Challenge League.
It's just a great season for both teams. I mean, the season of the rabbit, I mean, it was a theme from game day on. And he used it to the full extent. I mean, this wasn't played at the hour of the rabbit. That might have been the game deciding factor, actually. But I think it was a brilliant season anyway. I mean, that's a great achievement. Not a whole lot of coaches have been to the finals, so I think that's a very big one actually, and that's something to be really proud of. So I think
thanks for injecting so much fun into this season there, Shots.
Yeah, it was a great show every single game. I believe Shots is gone. Okay, so I think we can close this off. So I think in 30 minutes time, it might be on this Twitch, but check out the Discord and your games on Twitch. So in half an hour time, after a little bit of commercial break, we'll be back with the Challenge League Finals, which will conclude our Season 6. So thanks everybody out there for watching. If there's anybody out there who doesn't know the MML, check us out on mmlpro.com for background stories. I mean, we talked about it a little bit. For standings, our schedules, the teams, you can apply there to join our season, to join our league, play a couple games in the farm. Check out the podcast as well. Brilliantly done podcast coming out pretty much every week. With tons of info about not only the league but Blood Bowl in general and Blood Bowl on the PS4, worth a listen if you're out for a morning run or on the train ride or something, or just want to listen to Thundens and Preach's beautiful voices falling asleep. It's perfect entertainment there. As are all of our broadcasts. Check us out for more. And again, see you back here in half an hour. And thanks for participating in the. In the Twitch, in the chat there. Great performance, guys out there.